Let's take a look at this diagonalization theorem. So we'll see what it says, why it says what it says, and we'll take a look at a concrete example. So first, suppose I have a 2x2 matrix, and suppose I also have some eigenvectors, some linearly independent eigenvectors. Suppose it's v1 with eigenvalue lambda 1, and v2 with eigenvalue lambda 2. That tells me that A times V1 is lambda 1 V1, and A times V2 is lambda 2 V2. I'm going to construct this matrix P, whose columns are V1 and V2. And notice, since I'm assuming that V1 and V2 are linearly independent, this matrix P is invertible by the invertible matrix theorem. If I compute what A times P is, well, it's A times this matrix whose vectors are, column vectors are V1 and V2. The first column is going to be A times V1, and the second column is going to be A times V2. But from above, we see that that's just lambda 1 V1 and lambda 2 V2. And I can write that as a matrix product. The first matrix is going to be the matrix V1, V2, and the second will be this diagonal matrix with the eigenvalues on the main diagonal. Right, so I'll call that P, and then this one is going to be a diagonal matrix D. And so I get that A times P equals P times D, where P is this invertible 2x2 matrix, and D is a diagonal 2x2 matrix. Now let's see what we can do with this equation. If I multiply on the left by on both sides by P inverse, notice that P inverse times P is just the identity matrix, and so on the right side, I get this diagonal matrix D, and so I get that P inverse AP is a diagonal matrix. Similarly, I could redo the computation multiplying on the right by P inverse on both sides. P, P inverse is the identity, and so I get that A equals P, D, P inverse. And so what this says is the fact that A has linearly independent, two linearly independent eigenvectors, tells me that A is similar to a diagonal matrix. And this technique works in general for any n by n matrix A, whenever we have n linearly independent eigenvectors. What we're going to do, right, if the eigenvectors are v1 up to vn with eigenvalues lambda 1 up to lambda n, we're going to be able to write A as P times D times P inverse, where D is this diagonal matrix whose main diagonals entries are the eigenvalues, and this invertible matrix P gotten by just taking those linearly independent eigenvectors and putting them as columns of a matrix P. And this is called the diagonalization theorem. It tells us that a matrix is diagonalizable. It's similar to a diagonal matrix if and only if we can find a basis of eigenvectors, so n linearly independent eigenvectors for an n by n matrix. Let's take a look at a concrete 3x3 example. Let's try to diagonalize this matrix A, which is 2, 0, minus 2, 1, 3, 2, 0, 0, 3. And just to make things a little bit easier so that we don't have to factor a characteristic polynomial, suppose you're also given the eigenvalues. And so in this case, we're given that the eigenvalues are 2 and 3. Well, if we want to diagonalize it, this is going to break up into two pieces. We need to find a basis for the lambda equals 2 eigenspace, and then we also need to find a basis for the lambda equals 3 eigenspace. Now remember, any eigenvector with eigenvalue 2 is going to be linearly independent from any eigenvector with eigenvalue 3, because 2 is not equal to 3. Right? Distinct eigenvalues give you linearly independent eigenvectors. And so what this is going to tell us is that we can diagonalize A, we can find 3 linearly independent eigenvectors, as long as the dimensions of these eigenspaces add up to 3. Right? Then A is going to be diagonalizable. So we'll just compute each of these eigenspaces, find the basis for each one, see if we have the dimensions add up to 3 or not. So we look at A minus 2 times the identity, and I get this matrix, 0, 0, minus 2, 112, 001. Right, so remember, when you're subtracting off 2 times the identity, all you're going to do is subtract 2 from the main diagonal. Now, we want to compute the null space of this matrix, and so I set up the augmented matrix, and now I'm just going to row reduce, right? Because all I want to do is find the null space of that matrix so that I can find a basis for the null space of that matrix. Now, here it is in reduced echelon form. Let me put boxes around my pivot so that it's easier to see what the basic and free variables are. And I see that the eigenspace can be described as, well, x2 is free, and I see that x1 has to be minus t if x2 is t, and this is for all t in R, which tells me in parametric vector form, the solution space is just given by t times this column vector minus 1, 1, 0. Right, so the eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue 2 is one-dimensional with basis minus 1, 1, 0. What about the eigenspace for 3? I'm going to compute A minus 3 times the identity. I get this matrix here. Again, I want to compute the null space of that matrix, so I set up the augmented matrix and row reduce. In this case, the row reduction is easy. Let me put a box around the pivot to highlight the free and basic variables. I see that the eigenspace is described by, well, now in this case, x2 and x3 are non-pivot columns, and so those are free. Let me call them free parameters s and t. And x1 is minus 2t. And so in parametric form, the solution set looks like x equals s times 0, 1, 0 plus t times minus 2, 0, 1. So the lambda equals 2 eigenspace has basis minus 1, 1, 0. The lambda equals 3 eigenspace has basis 0, 1, 0 and minus 2, 0, 1, which tells me now that by the diagonalization theorem, I can write as P, D, P inverse, where D is this diagonal matrix with 2, 3, 3 on the main diagonal. And P, now the important thing here is, since I listed in the diagonal matrix the eigenvalue 2 first, I need to put the eigenvector corresponding to eigenvalue 2 first. So I put minus 1, 1, 0. And then next I'm going to list the basis for the lambda equals 3 eigenspace, 0, 1, 0, minus 2, 0, 1.